Recently, I had come upon this paper which originated from an amateur chemistry forum called the sciencemadness forums titled Synthetic Routes to Tetrazole Compounds Based on OTC Materials, and describes the many ways of obtaining an extremely explosive, energetic compound relay from urea. Even though 5-aminotetrazole itself is an exciting energetic, the whole procedure seems kinda boring. But then, after reading the whole write-up, it proved to be actually really interesting. Especially since most of this procedure is just playing with stuff that can kill you by the milligrams. And for the first step, we'll be turning urea into calcium cyanate using some calcium carbonate and heat. Urea is something that you can get at your local hardware store in the fertilizer section, and you can also extract it from pee if you're really weird. I don't judge. Calcium carbonate, on the other hand, can be found in nature. I found mine in the form of seashells on my local beach. And the cool part about using seashells is that you don't really have to purify them, because they're like 95% calcium carbonate anyway. Because the two things have to be mixed in a powder form, I've put them into a coffee grinder.
God.
Next, I started hitting the whole thing with a blowtorch. At first, nothing was really happening, but then a bunch of fumes erupted from the powder because a reaction started happening. Under heat, the urea decomposes into ammonia and isocyanic acid. Then this isocyanic acid reacts with the calcium carbonate to form calcium cyanate in an acid-base reaction. The paper calls for using calcium oxide, however, because calcium oxide is expensive, or at least more expensive than seashells, I'm using calcium carbonate. However, there is a pretty big problem, because if you use calcium carbonate, then a bunch of carbon dioxide is generated along the cyanate, which can cause an overflow. For example,
oh no, it's about to overflow. What am I going to do? Strike!
Eventually, the whole thing solidified, and using a chisel, I've broke up this slag into smaller portions, and I've weighed it out. We've got around 86 grams of pretty pure calcium cyanate, and it's a pretty good yield as far as this channel goes. Also, cyanate may sound bad, but it really isn't. I mean, sure, if you eat it or something, then you will die, but otherwise it's pretty vanilla. The next step calls for the decomposition of calcium cyanate into calcium cyanamide by heat. So first of all, I've put all of the slag into a steel paint can, and then I threw it into a bonfire. You have to make sure that the lid is placed very well to limit any air from getting into the paint can. This reaction really isn't that deep, it's just a simple decomposition by heat. And if all goes well, we end up with cyanamide and with a little bit of carbon dioxide on the side.
It's pretty much glowing in there, I mean, isn't it? I mean, probably.
To confirm that the reaction indeed happened, I've dissolved some of the slag into some nitric acid, and then I've poured all of that into a silver nitrate solution. If there's a yellow precipitate, then that means that we did it, and if not, then I've fucked something up. Thankfully, the test was positive, and now I was able to move onto the next step of the procedure. This step will be making aminoguanidine, and this is actually a really in-depth process, so I'm going to turn on the nitrate mode for this. First of all, to some distilled water, I've added some sodium hydroxide pellets. This makes the solution highly basic at a pH of around 14. Because we ideally want it at around 9.5 on the pH scale, I started correcting the pH with some dilute sulfuric acid. After 10 minutes of this excruciating process, I finally reached the correct pH, and now we can begin the reaction. On the side, I've weighed out some hydrazine sulfate, which is the sulfate salt of hydrazine, which I've bought online, and some of the calcium cyanamide. Then I roughly stir the two reagents. Now let's start adding the mix. Once the hydrazine sulfate falls into the basic solution, it turns into its free base form, which dissolves in the water, and it reacts with the calcium cyanamide to form aminoguanidine and calcium sulfate. After a few additions, I've checked the pH, and the pH paper turns this yellowish color, indicating the solution turning neutral, which was bad. So I've added some sodium carbonate, which is also a base, to correct the pH. Next, I've put a glass dish on top to limit the eventual hydrazine vapors that may escape from the flask. After letting it react for like 20 minutes, I've adjusted the pH to 7, which is neutral, and now it's time to start hitting everything. When it comes to amateur chemistry, this is the peak of dangerous, because we've got here a solution of hydrazine, and we're going to be boiling the hell out of it, so yeah, this is going to be fun. This was extremely stressful, because I really did not want the solution to boil, because if it did, then it would release hydrazine vapors. Still though, in the end, everything went fine, and now it was time to vacuum filter it. Most of the slag in the filter is just calcium sulfate, which had fallen out of the solution, and some dirt, I guess. And then I start adding some sodium bicarbonate. This bicarbonate reacts with the newly formed aminoguanidine sulfate and turns it into aminoguanidine bicarbonate, which is not soluble in water. After the addition, the solution had this yellowish tint, which meant that we were on a good track. I've left it overnight for aminoguanidine bicarb crystals to appear, and once they did, they looked really freaking cool. Anyway, for the next step and the second to last step, the paper entails that we make an azide intermediate. For those who aren't that into chemistry, an azide is an extremely dangerous ion to be around, since it's usually really explosive. However, because the azide is just an intermediate and is going to be dissolved in water, it's not going to be that bad. Alright, so first I've made a weak nitric acid solution by adding some fumic nitric acid into some water. Then I've dissolved all the aminoguanidine bicarbonate in it. The bubbling is from the bicarbonate ion reacting with the acid to form CO2. Then I've quickly made a solution of sodium nitrite. Then I've added the stir bar, turned on the stirring, and I started adding the sodium nitrite solution. Here we are performing a diazotization reaction of the aminoguanidine nitrate into guanyl azide. After a few additions, the whole thing turns this yellowish color, most likely due to nitrous acid formation. Anyway, next I let it sit like this for like 20 minutes to react, and then I added a bunch of sodium carbonate into it. This neutralizes the excess acid and acts as a catalyst for the cyclization of the guanyl azide. If you haven't noticed, we've just transitioned into the last step of the synthesis, aka making 5-aminotetrazole. After the addition, the solution turns this yellowish color, and I honestly have no idea why that is. Anyway, I've added the yellow solution into a round bottom flask, and I've set up a hot water bath reflux. After letting it react for like 2 hours, I've neutralized the solution with sulfuric acid, and I've let it crystallize overnight. After that, I've woke up to an extremely shitty yield. I don't think even if I were to filter it, then I would be able to weigh it. Anyway guys, I guess we did it. We've made 5-aminotetrazole from seashells. However, these amounts are quite unsatisfactory to me. Still though, there will be a new video about making nitrotetrazole, and in that video, I'll make the 5-aminotetrazole using a different pathway from this paper. Just because I'm way too committed for this project.
Ayu, Prussian Blue is coming to Discord. You should join my Discord server now!